So yeah, welcome. My name is Willem.
I'm Mark.
And the one without the microphone, I think, is Rob.
Yeah.
Just speak loud.
Yes.
Well, thanks for turning up this early. I live in the UK and I left yesterday, so normally I'm sitting at home having a coffee at this time of day. And now we're going to do property-based testing by example.
Great. So, well, let's not spend too much time on ourselves. We're all three independent consultants, and for quite a few years we've been working together under the name of Quan, Quality Without a Name. You might have heard it. We do, besides working in projects, we also do training, mentoring, and we're also involved in organizing conferences.
Yeah.
You'd like to add something?
They're sold out, so.
Yeah, they're sold out. So, amongst others, XP Days, which is a great conference. Not like listening to people and watching a big screen, but also doing stuff,
yeah,
which is really good.
Yeah, Dev Winter in Cambridge, January 23rd. Not sold out yet.
Okay, so we are still doing software development ourselves. We are actually continuously looking for better ways of developing software, and that's one of the reasons we're doing this session. So this session we're going to focus on property-based testing. It's been around for a while, but it has been quite a niche topic until recently. Who has heard of property-based testing before, or has done something with it? Okay, you're all new.
Everybody's new to it, yeah.
Cool. So this is not a ready-made tutorial in property-based testing. This is part of our own discovery process of what is property-based testing about and how can you apply it and in what ways can it be useful. So keep that in mind while...
We'll struggle.
So property-based testing... who's doing unit testing? Almost everyone.
TDD?
Test-driven development?
Like first a test and then some code? Cool.
Okay. So when you're doing TDD, that test-driven development, put briefly, is as much as a testing technique as a design technique. Because if you start out with test, you have to really manage your dependencies, so it influences your design. We recently came on the path of property-based testing, which is a completely... different approach of approaching testing. It originates in Haskell with QuickCheck, and there it has remained in its niche for quite some time. But what it is in essence is that normally with unit testing, you write some examples of what your code is expected to do when you check if it actually does that. With property-based testing, you take a different approach. You define properties of your code, which basically are invariant conditions that should always hold about your object under test or your system under test. Then you have a library or framework that generates lots of random data and just fires it at your code under test. And whatever data is fired at it, the properties, the invariants should still hold. And if the library finds a counterexample that's interesting, so then apparently you found a bug in your code. So that's very briefly the idea. We're going to show this in a minute or a second. Well, let's start doing it. What we're going to do, we're going to show...
Briefly, maybe, sort of... we have this in the last slide as well, but I think it sort of bears repeating. Why would you want to do this?
Mm-hmm.
So maybe you found while writing tests, you sometimes have this thing like, okay, I've written 1, 2, 3 examples and now I'm going to have to write like 10, 20 more of the same tests or put some stuff in a list, get some crappy feedback. This is one of the reasons to do this. The other reason, so if you define properties over a bunch of things, it helps me find sort of corner cases in the data that I won't find if I'm exploring just piece by piece. And it's fun.
Okay, so the example we're going to work with is it's sorting, but it's just a little bit more than just sorting a list of strings or something like that. It's actually based on something we did in a project recently, a bit simplified and anonymized to...
Protect the innocent.
Protect the innocent, yeah. So the idea is we're going to create menus. We get a list of of dishes, and each dish is attached to a course. Like we have for the main course, we have, for example, roast beef, and we have an as drinks, for example, ranja or beer or coke or whatever you like. The idea is that we want to group this list by the courses and then have the dishes sorted per course. I hope this the desired output kind of shows this.
Well, so almost. There's two. Who can spot the errors in the code? Just to see if you're awake.
Who can spot the errors in the code?
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, actually, it's JavaScript, so it's not an error.
No, exactly.
It just fail at some point. So yeah, that's the other thing about this tutorial. We will be using curly braces. We thought doing this in Haskell in the morning would be slightly too painful for the audience. So we're doing it in JavaScript. There is JUnit Quick Check, which does property-based testing in Java, but it's somewhat incomplete, so we can't show all the features of property-based testing.
Yeah. For the JVM, there's also a Scala check, which uses Scala, which is quite powerful, but it has quite some magic inside. And we thought that would not be a good idea to show what property-based testing would be about. So
this was sort of the simplest explaining thing that could possibly work.
The simplest demo that could possibly work, yeah. If you're really interested in this, I recommend you try this out. I started learning Haskell just to learn QuickCheck, and the combination of Haskell and QuickCheck is quite powerful. So if you're interested after this, try JS Verify, and maybe after that try it, or before that try it in Haskell.
Okay.
It's a shameless Haskell plug.
It's a shameless Haskell plug, yes.
Should we start?
Yeah.
You know, an interesting situation where we have only one chair for pair program.
Okay, maybe that can
I'll
be
get on my knees.
Just go on.
There are no loose chairs in the room, I see.
Come on.
We can sit with our backs to the audience in the first row, but I think that's a worse trade-off. Okay, so what do we have here?
Can everyone read this?
Even in the back?
Yeah, there's also still places left at the front, so if you want to zoom in.
Yeah, we won't bite you, promise.
We can also increase the font a little bit more if you want to. No?
We don't.
Okay. Yeah. So what we've done here is started using... So you can use property-based testing without regular testing or specking framework. But even while preparing this tutorial, we found that once you have more than one property, getting good feedback from sort of regular testing framework pays off already. So this is Jasmine.
Who knows Jasmine? Who doesn't?
Rob keeps checking that you are awake. Sorry.
Yeah. Jasmine is simple. So if you're used to JUnit, then describe is your test case class, and it is your test. That's really what it is.
Yeah, so Jasmine uses this, the RSpec style of writing tests, where you have blocks that are arbitrarily nested, and you write the names of your tests in plain text with spaces.
Yeah.
So a JFOL session early in the morning, this is our test case, and this is our unit test, should start with a failing test. And if you look at the bottom, you see a message, and it says expected property to hold, counter example found, a space. So our failing property is very simple. We generate strings. So in property-based testing, there are two things that you really have to know. There are generators. These are the functions that give you random data. So the library provides some, like this one, ASCII string. So this gives you a random string. So this thing here is a function that generates random strings. And then here we have a property. So all of the properties in our test start with for all something. So for all takes a generator function, and then it takes a test case, a test function basically. So this thing should return true for a value that's generated by the generator function. We have a comment here. I normally don't use comments, but in JS Verify and in property-based testing, you really want to have a look at what your random data is sometimes. And our failing property is, well, we generate a string and we assert that the string is empty, and that's going to fail, of course, because it's going to generate random strings, but we just wanted to show what it looks like when it fails. So what's interesting about the counterexample found a space is that it's a space. It could generate any strings. So what JS Verify does, that JUnit QuickCheck unfortunately doesn't, it generates outputs and then it shrinks it. So it tries to find the smallest counterexample to your property. So the smallest non-empty string it can find is a space. Doesn't say how. Oh yeah, it says if you look at the top of the output, it says started, failed after one test, and four shrinks. Maybe I should show the log.
Willem.
Yeah.
I don't know. Can everybody follow this? Because he's sometimes talking about the top level, but top window, and sometimes about the.
You have a cursor here. Sorry.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I was talking about this. So there's. It says failed after one test and five shrinks. This is interesting.
Yeah, it's continuously running the test.
It's continuously running the tests.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
This one is the auto test that you written didn't work on my Mac because of iNotify.
Oh, okay. So this is more challenging.
Yeah.
Okay. So what you see here is a constantly changing landscape of random tests. That's quite interesting. Mm-hmm. So it tries to really generates different things every time it runs the tests.
It's just falling over the edge of the. Can I go?
Oh, okay.
Oh, sorry.
Sorry.
If we do this, so this is fitting, I think.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the counterexamples are just falling off.
Now it's just, it's exactly showing the left part of the window. So this is better, I think.
Oh, okay. So what you see below started is that it generates small strings to start with and then tries to make them even smaller. So this is a bit different depending on the library you use. QuickCheck for Haskell generates strings up to about 40 characters or something. JS Verify tends to generate strings.
I think five characters by default.
So it's cool we have random data, but we want to do some sorting. So. What I found while doing this, if you use this kind of stuff for sorting, not very useful. Is the curly brace, is it bigger than a square bracket? I don't know. That kind of makes the tests hard to read. So we'll be using English dishes when we start sorting the menu.
Yeah.
This is also, I think there are only two bits in property-based testing, making properties and making random data. Finding the right random data to generate it takes time. You start with random strings and then you think, that doesn't look right. You look for something else. And so for production use, I found the same sort of finding understandable random data that means something is an interesting challenge. Okay.
Okay, let's start with our menu sort. No, I'll be fine. Okay. So let's say a menu. Sorted menu. So what property shall we start with? Or just check if the length of the input and the output are the same to start with something simple?
Yeah, there's when we prepared the demo, this is actually the second property we created. The thing that we really want to know is whether items are sorted. But we found that if you generate empty lists by accident, or you return empty lists, and that's sorted, then you need a second property. And so starting with the simplest property that you can make seems to be productive.
Yeah. So we have something like, what are you going to call it, the dishes that come in?
Yeah.
And the menu.length should be equal to dishes.length.
Yeah. And the triple equals is a JavaScript thing. If you don't use it, your booleans might accidentally turn into integers and stuff like that.
Yeah, we already have the menu sort function there.
and it returns an empty array. So that should fail.
Anything else? Yeah, well, I want to rename this
property. Maybe you should make the test passed first.
No. Three.
Yeah.
No.
Control-A.
Control-A?
Yeah, te laat. En nou weer een type.
You're confusing me.
Oh, sorry. That's my role, being noise.
Yes. Yeah. Okay, see what happens. Yeah, it now says there's one counter example. Ah, you forgot something. So what we want to have here are dishes should be an array of dishes.
That's what we forgot. Okay. Yeah. Do the renamings anyway.
Then. Yeah. I'll, so what we want to have is generator for dishes. The JS Verify has a special generator for that, an NE array, which stands for not empty array. Can we start with just the dish names for keep small steps?
Yeah. So you also see that we break our generators down into really tiny pieces. That is, amongst other things, so that we can check the output of each generator individually. It gets confusing pretty quickly. Yeah.
So I'm going to put in the English mains in a moment.
Yeah.
Grenstring staat er nog in.
Yeah.
The property,
so
yeah.
This should begin dishes.
Yeah. Yeah, sure. Yes. Ah, that's our import. So maybe we should show the import. So we made it easy on ourselves. We imported a bunch of things that we're going to use on the top.
With self-explanatory names like V and underscore and S.
In the best JavaScript conventions.
Yeah, V is from verify and S is from sorting.
Sorting and D is for dishes. And underscore is for underscore. Yeah. Underscore is a library that we use to get some collection functions, basically.
Okay, so now it fails, and we expect that to be because we faked the menu sort implementation. But let's that.
Yeah. So I think what's noticeable about this is that it shows in the error message it shows a counterexample, but it doesn't show the result of the function that we are creating. So that is something that I find confusing sometimes. We know that our menu sort actually returns an empty array, but there's nowhere you can see that in the error message. It just says I fed it this, and this thing doesn't work.
Yeah.
Right. It doesn't say empty array is not equal to whatever. It just say that this is a counterexample, which is a bit annoying.
Yeah.
Sometimes.
So what I do in. So sometimes I take these things out and write and put them in a unit test if they're really very confusing and keep them around. What we do with JS Verify is logging, and in Haskell there is a counterexample function that you can put inside your property to provide. So then you can also show what your function actually did, as opposed to what was just the input.
Okay, shall we put in the English dish names first?
Yeah.
Because I don't like I think the YT is not really tasty. So this is something we provided. We're not going to go into that. We have a module D, which just returns an array of all kinds of tasty English dishes. So instead of generating random ASCII strings, it's the element.
Yeah, which is exactly. I think it's elements.
Yeah, we'll see. We'll complain.
Yeah.
So what this does do is you just provide an array of allowed values and generate picks random values from that array.
So the dish names.
Yeah.
You need the English. It's comment. Yeah, it's.
So it's
remove
probably
the comment there. The syntax highlighting is broken.
It's all right. Yeah. So it was elements instead of elements. So now it says it gives a kind of. And the Lancashire hotpot doesn't do it.
Good.
All right. So this property doesn't check very much. So we could also make it work by just faking it. It's not yet what we wanted.
but it forces us to write another property.
Yeah. And this property, yes.
Yay.
Ship it.
Commit, push to production. All right.
Yeah, so we, sorry for delaying your renaming.
Yeah.
Are we going to name it? Should it have same length? Same length. Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
Probably works better if you do it in the place where you actually use it. Mm-hmm. Expect that same length to hold.
All right.
Cool.
And still passes.
Okay.
Okay. Next. Next property.
Yeah.
Let's do something with the actual sorting, checking if what comes out of it is sorted.
Yeah. Sorry, I'm just, I'll move the keyboard a bit. It should be sorted. By dish name?
Yeah, by dish name, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry? This IDE?
Yeah.
It's Vim.
Yeah.
Sorry? The runner?
The runner. I can show the runner. Is it the bash file or just the command line?
It's just the command line.
So it's just the thing here.
Yeah, so you can just
highlight
exit
this.
It.
This is the runner.
This is the auto tester, which is run in watch, which is run every
It is a bash
2 seconds.
So is it this? Or did you
No, I don't use you mean the auto tester?
Yeah. It's auto tester.
But I'm not using it.
No. So you're just running this.
Okay.
Oh, you're just running it in watch.
Yeah. I'm running it in watch.
Yeah, so I'll write it out in so there are two ways you can do this. This is the way we do it on
Linux.
Oh yeah, have changes.
You should do a split, I think. Or write it first?
No, just
this is a sidestep. We have a failing test, but this is a sidestep.
This is a sidestep. So basically, auto testers are really simple. You just need some command. This command doesn't exist on Mac, but you can download the tool that does just the same. So this just checks whether any file was created, modified, edited, whatever in the entire directory tree. Then it runs the check function. Check function clears the screen, runs JS hint, so it checks for compile errors, which you see lots of now.
Yeah, it's kind of sanity check for your JavaScript, who doesn't know it.
Yeah, it doesn't check much, but it's better than nothing. And then it runs the tests. JessMine also has a built-in autotester. I don't know why we don't. You can also do JessMine --- autotest if you install the correct modules in Node.
Yeah, being lazy.
Yeah.
You know,
we know Bash, yeah, so yeah. It's the simplest thing that could work. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, so and Rob's thing is just, I'll write it in a comment, it's just this watch -n how many seconds?
Every second, default, so it's 2.
Oh, so it's just watch.
Yeah, watch, and that command line that's highlighted under there.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So it's really simple.
Right?
Et cetera.
Yeah,
et cetera. So yeah, watch is great, it's very simple, works most of the time. Just quit this one.
Okay, so pop this off the stack and go back to the
let's go back. Yeah. So yeah, there's a lot of discussion. A lot of people in JavaScript land use gulp, which is slow, complicated, and fragile. And a one-line bash command does lots of the same things often. Should start the property from the bottom. Expect sorted. No.
Is sorted?
Sorted. Is sorted.
Sorted by dish name.
Sorted by dish name.
By dish name.
While Willem is typing, that's what we tend to do. Start with the assert and then work our way up to what we need to get that assert running.
Missing a D. I was wondering why the autocomplete didn't work. We're going to use the dishes generator again. Yeah. do this first because I always forget this. Okay, I don't have anything, so it's failing. That's good.
Yeah, it doesn't have a return, so it returns undefined, which kind of is false.
I can cheat, but at least we can see that it works.
Yeah, yeah. Don't cheat it.
Right. Okay, so how are we going to determine that it's sorted, Mark?
We have a nice utility function that says s.isSorted. Mm-hmm. It's around the menu. Yeah.
So you can do return s dot is sorted.
That's also one of the.
That's one of the words that weren't.
Menu.
Menu.
That should fail. It does.
Yeah. So beef becomes before Bedfordshire clanger.
And that's not good.
No.
It's funny that it's generating some of the same combinations all the time.
Question over there. Sorry?
Yeah.
So
we prepare that.
Yeah, so it's here.
Yeah,
so yeah. This is the other thing that's so for the purpose of the demo we already implemented a check that checks for various things that are sorted. It takes slightly too much time to do in the demo, and it's not that interesting. So we imported that.
And now everyone's curious for our implementation of this sorted. we can show afterwards.
Yeah, we can show. We are happy. We'll put this up on GitHub or something. You can have a look at it.
Right.
Okay, so we have a failing property. Mm-hmm. So now I'm going to pass the keywords back to you.
Let's make it work.
Yeah.
We could do that easily. Here we're going to use the underscore library, which has a very nice sort by method, which can also sort objects on certain properties, which we don't need now, but
also sort nil, which without warning, which is kind of dangerous.
Do we need to pass the function that returns what we want to sort on?
No, not yet.
Okay.
This just.
We have a list of. That's a good question. Yeah. We just have a list of strings. Maybe.
Okay. Cool. Yeah.
So if you look in the failing output, you see a list of strings. So a list of beef, Bedfordshire, clinger. I haven't seen the English breakfast yet, but it should be in there. So we just have a list of strings. So we want a menu that has a bit more structure to it. That has what we want. I think is something that has the name of a course and the name of a dish, and we can build a menu from
something
that.
Something
like in the slides.
Something like in the slides. Maybe you should.
We want input like this, where we have the course name and dish name.
Okay.
So next test. Or should we refactor before we do the next test?
What we found is it really pays off to do, when you start doing this and you make your properties very much dependent on all kinds of primitive data types like arrays and tuples, your properties become very prone when you decide to change your data structure and have new insights. So this might be a good idea to.
Yeah.
So where do we start? So we would like to have something. Maybe start with a generator. So we.
Okay, I thought you were going to introduce the menu class first. Just wherever you want to start is fine with me. I mean, introducing the generator and making directives is also a good point, so let's do that.
So let's introduce a gen dish, because I'm my gen dish. I want a dish to look like a JavaScript object with a course name. And I'm going to complete it in a moment before you wonder what I'm doing. And a dish name. And for the dish name, I'll use the existing dish name generator. And we'll introduce a new generator for the course name. So this line, the v.record, it's from JS Verify, and it generates objects with two properties that have randomly generated content.
Yeah, and the curly braces notation here is just a JavaScript way to write down a record, basically. Yeah. So in this case, we have a record that has our field names as key and as value has a generator function.
Yeah, so let's say for the course names, just pick a few, like we have starters, we have mains, we have desserts.
Dessert with, yeah. No, it's, yeah.
Yeah, right. License.
I spell it like desert all the time. Drinks.
Drinks.
It's mains. Else? Mains with an S.
Yeah. You're an English expert.
Yeah.
Starters, then?
Yeah, that, yeah, you're right. Yeah, yeah. It's either and desserts then.
Yeah. So we now have feed our properties with a different data structure. You could do a save to see where it breaks.
If it breaks. Yeah. So this is one of the strange things I've found sort of with JS Verify and JavaScript and underscore. The libraries we use are extremely flexible. We can change stuff around and it will still work. And sometimes I think maybe it should fail here at this point.
So the thing with this is the sort by from underscore just can sort everything you feed it to it. But what you actually do is, I think I want to get this right first.
Yeah.
What I actually want to do, I have dish objects here, which have a dish name. I want to have them sorted by dish name. And so that's why we started out with the underscore sort by at first, because I can just say, well, use this this property.
Would this work if we put this in the test first instead of the implementation?
I was going to say that, nitpicking, do it in the
test
first.
No, it's not nitpicking.
It's 2-1, so I can't object to that.
I'm afraid that 2 will pass, but that's the
okay, that's so the you're suggesting to...
yes, if you see it, you own it. Okay, so our fantastic isSorted function already has some facility for this, so I can reveal intention quite easily. Yay,
and it works.
It fails.
Yeah. So we also wrote our isSorted that you can say, I want to check if this if the list is sorted by this this provided property.
Do you feel the relief by Willem that his test is actually failing?
Yeah.
So sometimes failing is really good.
Yeah. I had this with JS Verify a bit more than with Quick Check in Haskell because JavaScript is very flexible. Underscore accepts sorts undefined if you let it. Yeah. So I found myself using console.log quite a bit more than I'm used to. So yeah, I'm very glad that it's failing.
Okay. Fix it.
So yeah, fix it. Mark?
Yeah, I'll redo my change again.
Yeah, that's ping pong programming, guys. He does the ping, the other one does the pong.
So this should make it work.
Yay, yes. Okay.
Okay.
Great. Yeah, so the thing with sort of writing properties, the steps, because you test so much data once, the steps tend to be a bit bigger than sort of a regular unit test. So what Rob and I both did in preparing the demo is quite often we didn't trust the properties completely. We wrote a few unit tests just to make sure that we actually knew what we were doing, which, as it turned out, we often didn't.
Especially because, again, it only shows counterexamples. It doesn't show the output if it failed.
Yeah, in hindsight, I think we should have written the helper function to help us show the input, the outputs. That's for the next one. Okay. So do we go on to the next test? Because we want to have our menus grouped by course.
Yes.
Or should we do some refactoring to make our next test easier first?
I'm looking at the time, so maybe just do the extra property.
Okay.
I also want to have a bit of time to reflect on what we did. So
it should be grouped by course name. With properties, naming your variables properly becomes even more important. We didn't explain it, but we consciously choose to prefix our generators. I normally don't do this with variables. But if you have things that generate dishes, dish names and generators of dish names, it gets confusing very quickly. So you could see in the slide we had course instead of course name, but you could say this thing, it's a dish. But if you combine certain things, if you combine them in a list and group them, it's a course. So if you're, the thing here is named the course, and the thing you're grouping inside the menu, you name a course, but it's not a structure in your code, very confusing. So this is a course name, and we group things by course name.
It says function. No, function.
Yeah.
And then the C.
Yeah, Mark did provide me with something close to an English breakfast, but I'm out of coffee at the moment. It's grouped by course name. Yep. So that's also the reason why we split up our tests like that. So it looks kind of silly to just have a variable here and the code that makes the variable is just here. But the level of nesting, if you combine sort of RSpec style testing that Jasmine does, you get describe it, and then you get function, and the nesting gets, so far I can't read it. So we tend to extract things.
You missed it to hold.
Oh, yeah. To holds. Okay. Yay. Going to use for all again.
Again, the dishes.
This is getting a bit repetitive, so if this wasn't the demo, I'd be extracting this after the demo edit. And the same here. Okay, so wishful thinking time. What does grouping look like? Are we going to say something like this, or you want? We don't have the menu yet. Given the time, maybe we just make a function.
Yeah. So grouping means that I would like to have what you call sub collections of all the dishes that belong to, for example, mains or starters. And I could, for example, check if I have such a group of dishes, whether all the course names are the same, because then they're grouped.
So you want to check that all courses are the same. So you get a list of courses back.
Let's start with some wishful thinking. So we have. So we're going to change the what menu looks like.
Not sure if we have enough time to do that. We could start with a function and then see if we wanted to add it to a class. So we could say courses is something. So we could say, I think the menu is still a list of dishes, so we could just start with the implementation in the test. And maybe while I type Rob can talk about TDD as if you really meant it. So that's what I'm doing here.
Yeah.
So right now we are a bit stuck. We don't have an idea about the design. And what do we do, Rob?
You just write the implementation in the test itself.
So we do we have a group by in underscore.
It takes menu. I'm going to abuse the fact that the menu is already sorted, so we don't have to do anything with that, hopefully. Yeah. So I assume that if we group this thing, the things that are in the group, so the dishes that are in each course will still be sorted. That's a gamble, and our property is going to help us out in a bit.
Yeah. And we're going to group by the course name.
Yeah.
All right.
Now we can use your trick. We can use this, I think.
So if we...
you can put that in a variable as well, if you want. Or it can just be a return here.
So actually, what I would like to do, there's a very handy... But actually, what I want to have here is something like an array with all the dishes in this, if you follow me. So this would be first all the mains, then all the first all the starters, then all the mains, whatever. This group by doesn't give me exactly that. It gives me basically a dictionary which maps the course to an array. So I want to do a bit of underscore magic here, because yeah. I just want to have the values of that thing.
Yeah, now that I saw Mark writing this comment here while explaining, I think this would be the point where Ed writes a unit test just to write an example of the output that I actually want.
So this is my course. What I want to check here. For every group, so every array of dishes that's in here, I basically want to check if they all have the same course. Just to check if I get my JavaScript right. So this function gets
true.
To see if I didn't make any other mistakes.
Yeah, okay, yeah. That works.
So for this array of dishes, there's another handy function in underscore. Oh, I forgot to start editing.
Yeah, so basically you want to see whether we have just one course name in a list of yeah. dishes inside a course.
Which is yeah.
So I want all the unique course name values.
And you need to pass in a false here.
Oh yeah.
Which I forgot yeah. what it was for.
That's a bit of noise, not relevant for here, but no. Unique really wants to know if the thing is already sorted, because then it can take a shortcut. But if I get the list of unique courses and...
there's more than one course name, that's not good.
Yeah. So there should be only one unique course name for every group of dishes.
Which probably is not. Which
oh, yes.
is
true.
Yeah.
There is, because we have the implementation right
there. Oh, yeah, we have the implementation. Yeah.
Okay, so I think this is the point where we should stop. And
yeah. Well, no, actually, I think, can we put this in the menu sort?
Rob, how are we for time?
We are
5 minutes left.
5 minutes left.
So oh, we have 5 minutes left. Yeah. Okay, so yeah, maybe
you can
make
tell
clear.
What we would do if we had...
Yeah, so mm-hmm. line 41 is part of the implementation that should go into the menu sort. So what we sometimes do is just write that into the test until it's good, and then move it over to the implementation. Sort of an extra extreme sort of TDD style, making really small steps.
When you're really stuck.
Yeah, just fiddle with your test until it works, and then move the implementation to your actual implementation code, which is really odd, isn't it?
Yeah.
Sorry? In the test, yeah. So even if you would let it fail first, then still you could write the implementation in the test. It's from a session that we once did called a TDD as if you really meant it.
By Keith Braithwaite.
Yeah. Which is a really extreme form of really small steps and then moving things into your implementation. So line 41 would go into the menu sort, mm-hmm. which would probably fail the first test because the length would be different because it's now grouped. So we'll have to fix that as well. But that's sort of how it would work. It would still be sorted, but maybe also the is sorted would not be just menu on dish name, but menu and then flatten it first and then go on to the dish name.
Yeah, or say, well, I refine a property that for every course, the item should be sorted. So you do like an every on the array.
And then you slowly see that part of the property also goes into functions, and that sort of sometimes feels that it needs to go into the implementation as well to make it more readable.
That's one of the things I was thinking about. So if you write invariants in your property, so things that should be true for all all objects in your system, basically. So if you have invariants like that, you can just as well move them to the implementation. So you can use that for monitoring, for instance. So are all my customers like I think they should be? Mm-hmm. Or we can make a sample in the implementation and check that our customers are actually doing stuff according to the invariants. We get some data, we check an invariant, and that's it. So you can just as well sample your production data and see if it holds to the invariants that you think should hold. So what you saw here, you were absolutely right. We wrote the implementation first before the test. So because you check things over all of the things in your domain, properties can get quite complicated sometimes. We didn't plan to write it first, but the unique function in underscore is scary enough that I find the thing that's in the implementation easier to write than the property. So let's switch
time
to the slides.
A few observations. Yes. Okay, so it's for us still a journey of discovery. Although this approach does have some promising aspects. So one of the things I really like is thinking about invariants, which normally are kind of implicit in your code, and they are there, but it's very hard to spot if you make mistakes in there. What we also see is to formulate really good generators, that also takes some time, and sometimes it's even more work on the properties. But that's a good thing, because it really forces you to think about what is valid input for my system under test. So for this example, we decided to use the given list of English courses, and that's kind of okay for a domain model. But if I would use this for example, testing validation or some kind of adapter that takes in data from the evil outside world, I really want to have it tested with random strings and all kinds of data I would normally forget in a regular unit test.
Yeah, where actually I think you can do filters on your generators that filters out things that you don't want. So if you want to have ASCII strings, but you don't want the curly braces and the square brackets and the apologies and so on, then you can say, I want it to be, what's the function again? I don't know. You can filter them out.
Yeah, the downside of that is that you have to be careful that it can still generate enough actual data. So sometimes your tests might fail because it will say, okay, after 10,000 attempts, I couldn't generate enough relevant examples. Some properties are complex enough for unit tests. Real data is more understandable than random things, what Rob just said. The other thing about real data I was doing, I was parsing tweets recently. I've written about 15 unit tests, and I thought, yeah, this is going well. I'm getting the URLs out, I'm getting the mentions out, it's awesome. And then I wrote a simple property, and the property was, if I parse a tweet into tokens, and then I generate the tweet back from the things that I parsed, then it should be the same. It's a very, very simple property. And then I found lots and lots and lots of edge cases I never thought about. Mm-hmm. If you have a URL at the end of the tweet, there's some weird Unicode escape character that's three dots, which is actually one character in Unicode, which I didn't know. So quite often you can write one property and you can get lots of test cases for that. Same for marshalling, for instance. Yeah. So if you have to JSON and from JSON, the both things should be the same. So it's a very simple property, but making that right can be a bit of work. So you learn more than you set out about your target language. So you get things about floats, Unicode. Oh yeah, using a string here. Do I really want people to write curly braces in their first name? Maybe not. And that's a good thing because that maybe makes you think about validation a bit more often.
Yeah.
I tend to be quite optimistic when I work test first. So I'll write some corner cases, but yeah, the stuff you can find out about floats and strings while doing this, like, yeah, maybe I should be a bit more careful.
Yeah, and the other thing we noticed is, especially if you have the powerful function for underscore or other maps and powerful collection functions, it's very easy to write cool one-liners. and have the properties based on primitive data structures, but that is really going to hurt you when, because you do get new insights and you do want to change the structure. We didn't do that too much in the demo because we're kind of limited in time, but it really pays off to refactor out objects and to encapsulate all kinds of details and to not make your properties too much dependent on all the small primitive details in your model.
Yeah, and I find myself doing things like putting an ID into a separate class instead of just a string, or a customer name in a separate class, or well, money is a prime example, of course, but see plenty of code base where you just see numbers floating around instead of something that's nice and encapsulated.
Yeah. I think we have some more. Yeah, we kind of covered this. And the thinking about the generators, that also helps about thinking about preconditions. And it does influence your design, but I'm not really have a final conclusion of how it how exactly it does. So
I think we said most of this as well. For things like testing validation logic, it's also quite useful. What we find is that sort of the kind of random data that you use for sort of regular code as opposed to validation is different.
Yeah.
So it's like the random strings with all the curly braces and the square brackets, etc., is great for validation.
Mm-hmm.
It's not so good for test for regular data, but yeah, if you want to throw whatever at your code, it's great.
Okay, well, the slide will be distributed. We've included a few links, and we also have a different tutorial on GitHub if you want to try it at home in JavaScript or Haskell.
Yeah, and if you want to see more, can you go back?
Yeah.
So I really recommend watching John Yu's presentations, testing the hard stuff and staying sane. So he's one of the inventors of QuickCheck. And in this presentation, he explains some of the things that he's used QuickCheck for over the years, including finding hard to find bugs in asynchronous systems.
Right. Okay, that's it.
Thank you very much.
If there's no time for questions, but we'll be around, so feel free to ask us. Hope you enjoyed.
Thank you.